Doctors depend on them. The Japanese are known for them. Celebrities are turning them into fashion statements. As COVID-19 sweeps through the land, suppliers can't make enough, and some American medical experts are urging the public not to wear them. In today's video, the truth about masks and how to make your own out of materials you probably have around the house. Protective masks come in all shapes, sizes, and designs, but they all boil down to three characteristics. One, an absorbent or reactive cartridge for protection from toxic substances. Two, a physical shield against impact, splatter, or other assaults. Three, some provision for clean, breathable air. When it comes to disease transmission, we're concerned with the latter two, and masks that fall into two broad categories. Nuisance masks, and respirators. Nuisance masks include surgical masks, but also simple bandanas and the dust masks from the hardware store. They're often cheap and disposable, and may not form a seal over your nose and mouth. Respirators are designed for environments in which the air is deemed not safe to breathe. They include masks designed to filter particulates out of the air, and more complex systems designed to supply clean air from a tank, like those used by firefighters and scuba divers. Filter masks range from the better hardware store dust masks that form a seal over the mouth and nose, all the way up to military chemical warfare masks, with everything in between. The higher end masks often come equipped with absorbent cartridges to deal with chemical fumes. Respirators are industrial PPE, or personal protective equipment. And their ability to filter particulate matter from the air is regulated in the United States by NIOSH, the National Institute for Occupational Safety and Health. Masks certified as N95 or better are engineered to trap particles as small as viruses or the fine dusts produced in industry. What we commonly call a surgical mask, any flat filter material tied across the face with no way of forming a seal, isn't a respirator and can't offer N95 protection no matter what it's made of. So what kind of mask do you need? Or do you need one at all? And what's with all the fuss? In Asia, people are accustomed to the sick wearing masks to avoid spreading illness to others, and experts have told the press it's common sense that they protect the wearer too. That seems reasonable. Though during every outbreak, crack investigative journalists are quick to point out that only N95 masks can trap viruses. Meanwhile, as I record this, the American CDC is telling people not to bother, and some medical authorities are even telling people not to wear masks even if they already have them at home. Who's right? What's going on? The truth, as is often the case, is deeper than the sound bites, and crafting simple public messaging for a complex issue becomes even harder when officials and journalists mistake informed opinion for good science. So let's break it down. First, let's all agree that medical professionals need protection far more than the general public, as they don't have the option of avoiding the sick, and they're vitally needed in times of epidemic, right when the demand for masks is highest. If you don't already own a suitable mask, this is reason enough not to rush out and stock up in the middle of a crisis and contribute to global shortages. Second, masks are not spacesuits, and are no guarantee against infection. N95 masks trap virus particles, but only about 95% of them. N100 masks are more expensive and harder to come by, and still only trap 99.97% of virus particles. Masks can't provide permanent invulnerability, and they aren't meant to. They're meant to give enough protection to manage the risk while you do what you have to do. And masks bring their own risks. Respirators in particular have to press against your face to form a seal. They're usually held on by elastic bands that are tight and uncomfortable, and it takes concentration and practice to remove them without spreading germs around your head. It's also hard not to reach up and reposition them when they start cutting off the circulation. Better masks can be more secure and comfortable, often with larger filters that are easier to breathe through, and exhaust valves that keep exhalations from escaping around the nose to fog the glasses or blow germs right into your eyes. But these masks have to be fitted to the wearer and still take practice and care to use properly. And in a pandemic situation, they can spread infection unless carefully sterilized after each use. Realistically, the only kind of mask that's practical for most people in most situations is the simple surgical mask, the very kind authorities are asking you not to buy and insisting can't stop viruses anyway. Or can they? It turns out this guidance is based on supposition, not on actual science. After the SARS outbreak in the early 2000s, several studies suggested that simple surgical masks can actually be quite protective. Then in September of last year, the Journal of the American Medical Association published a well-designed study that followed nearly 3,000 healthcare workers at 5 U.S. facilities over 4 annual flu seasons and found no statistically significant difference between the protection offered by plain old surgical masks as opposed to N95 masks. But how can this be? We're told surgical masks are only meant to keep surgeons from contaminating their patients and maybe protect them from the odd splash of blood or bodily fluid. They can't filter out things as small as a virus, can they? Well, a paper published in Health Engineering in 2016 documented experiments using a test chamber that found they can. But more importantly, it found that even for the best masks, leakage around the seal is generally higher than previously suspected, and overall, surgical masks were about as effective at stopping particles of the sizes of bacteria and viruses. But if you think about it, masks don't actually have to filter out tiny virus particles. Very few viruses are transmitted primarily by naked virus, and patients with respiratory infections in particular can't help ejecting virus-laden droplets of water when they sneeze, cough, or even when they talk. Surgical masks may not filter out individual virus particles, but they can stop a speck of moisture small enough to float on the air for minutes, maybe hours, and big enough to contain millions of virus particles. And remember, you don't have to seal yourself off hermetically from the outside world. The fewer virus particles you are exposed to, the more likely your body is to destroy them, and if it doesn't, the more time it will have to build up its immunity while any infection grows. And of course, you can't touch your mouth or nose if they're covered by a mask, and that's the single biggest vector of infection. Wearing a mask, even a poor one, can make it less likely you'll get sick, can delay your getting sick, and can reduce the intensity and duration of your sickness. How can that ever be a bad thing? Of course, you need the right mask for the job. During a major outbreak, or if you're particularly vulnerable, you might want to wear something more substantial if you absolutely have to go to the ER or wait in line at the DMV. But in lower risk environments, or around the house when you're caring for a family member who's sick, or trying to protect one from your own illness, there is nothing more practical than the disposable ear loop mask. These are easy to put on, comfortable, and easy to take off without wiping cooties all over your face. It's worth pointing out that a standard N95 disposable mask is easily converted to use ear loops. Just remove one of the staples from each strap, staple them in place to make loops, test fit and tighten as necessary, and pin the straps in place with a final staple. But what if you don't have any mask, and you want one for walks around the neighborhood? What if you want a mask that costs practically nothing, one that you can stick in your bag and have ready when you need it? Believe it or not, it's actually quite simple to make such a mask, and while it won't earn any N95 rating from NIOSH, my guess is it's nearly as good as a surgical mask. Start with a paper towel. I use shop towels because they're thicker and softer, but most any kind will do. Now fold it back and forth into pleats. Make the folds reasonably flat and tight, as they'll help shape the mask later. Now find a small paper clip and a few inches of flexible tape. Fabric tape like duct tape or medical tape works best. Straighten the paper clip, leaving both ends folded and curved. Tape the paper clip firmly to the mask to form a nose clip that will eliminate most of the leakage around your eyes. Now, find two similar rubber bands. Medium-sized envelope bands are best, but common household rubber bands work fine. The ones shown here, however, are much too strong. Don't use anything so stout. Fold the ends of the mask over the rubber bands and staple them in place. You may need to mash them down a bit to get them in, and a couple of staples through each side will usually hold fine if the staple is too short to penetrate all the way through the folded paper.
And there you have it.
These masks may not be perfect, but they might be better than you would think. And it's easy enough to fold one over, stick it in a bag, and always have it with you when you're stuck on a bus during flu season. If you like this video, please go ahead and hit the like button. And if you haven't already, subscribe and hit the notification bell so you won't miss any of the science goodness. And if you want more of my science and science fiction, you can support my writing on patreon.com or buy my sci-themed merchandise at teespring.com. You can also find me on Amazon and audible.com.